In this video module of the Edgedetect walkthrough, we will cover adding a sliding window memory architecture to increase performance. In the previous video module, we discovered there was a performance bottleneck due to reading multiple times from a memory with a single read port. In order to understand how to improve the architecture, we need to look at the algorithm and do some analysis. Typically, pure algorithmic descriptions will have performance bottlenecks, and this is because there is no explicit memory architecture coded in the design. This is the type of issue we encountered in the previous example. The array access patterns of the algorithm need to be analyzed in order to see how to optimize the memory architecture of the design. The array access patterns of the horizontal derivative function from the previous example show that the algorithm only needs to process 3 pixels for any given output. Furthermore, if you look at the computation for each output for the horizontal derivative, it becomes apparent that 2 of the previous values that were read from the DAT in memory are being reused for each subsequent computation. In other words, data is shifting or sliding across the line of pixels. This behavior can be exploited by creating a shift register or sliding window memory architecture for the horizontal derivative function. The goal of this memory architecture is to reduce the reading of a memory or an I/O to once per clock cycle, which allows pipelining the design with an initiation interval of 1. The memory architecture for the horizontal derivative is quite simple. It consists of 2 registers that implement our shift register. The input data is only ever read 1 time per iteration of the horizontal derivative loops, and it gives us access to 3 values of the input data simultaneously once the hardware has ramped up. The outputs are then selected from the taps of the shift register depending on where we are within the line of pixels. There is logic that controls the replication at the boundary for both the right boundary as well as the left boundary. The vertical derivative sliding window memory architecture is very similar to the horizontal derivative architecture, except that instead of shifting through registers, we are shifting the data through line buffer memories. Similarly to the last example, we have reduced the reading of DAT in to a single read per iteration of the vertical derivative loops. The data is then shifted through the line buffers, where each line buffer stores a previous line of pixel data, and the output gives us simultaneous access to 3 pixel values from the input image, and the boundary condition processing selects between the actual data from either the input, the line buffers, or selects the middle tap depending on whether or not we're replicating at the bottom of the image or the top of the image. Before we begin synthesizing the design, let's look at the code changes that were made in order to add the sliding window memory architecture. 2 line buffer arrays, as well as a couple pixel variables, have been added for the vertical derivative. These line buffer arrays will be mapped to memories in Catapult. The vertical row processing loop has been modified to add 1 extra iteration. This is required because the hardware needs to ramp up in order to be able to do the windowing and the replication at the boundaries. The line buffers are being read for each iteration of the column loop and stored in local pixel variables. The reading of the input memory DAT in is guarded to prevent from reading out of bounds since we've added an extra iteration for the row loop. And then the data is shifted through the memories, where line buff 0 stores the current line of pixel data and line buff 1 gets the previous line of pixel data. We have explicit boundary condition processing, so at the top of the image we reflect the center pixel to pixel 2, and at the bottom of the image we reflect the center pixel to pixel 0. And lastly, because the window has to ramp up, we ignore the first iteration, and after the first iteration of V row, we begin computing the derivative and writing it out to the DY array. The horizontal derivative function has a similar set of code changes, with the exception that we do not need line buffer arrays to store pixel data, Rather, we have local variables, pixbuff 0 and pixbuff 1, that will be synthesized as our shift registers. Similar to the vertical derivative code changes, for the horizontal derivative, we need to add one extra iteration for the column loop in order to allow the window to ramp up. Pix 1 and pix 2 read the previous pixel data from the shift register. The reading of the input data from dat in is guarded to prevent it from reading out of bounds. And the boundary condition processing reflects the center pixel for both the left and right boundary conditions. The pixel data is then shifted through the shift registers. And after the window has ramped up, the derivative is calculated and written out to the DX memory. And lastly, the clip function is removed because we are now explicitly coding the boundary conditions into the vertical and horizontal derivative calculations. Now let's go ahead and synthesize the design in Catapult to see if we've achieved our performance and area goals. The architectural optimizations done in the C code have reduced the latency from 5.6 million cycles down to 3.3 million cycles. However, we are still 3x over our desired performance goals. Before we begin doing some analysis, let's also look at architectural constraints to see how the design has been constrained, as well as the types of interfaces and storage. We still have our memory interfaces on the top-level design. As we will see later, at some point, these need to be converted to streaming interfaces. And then internal to the design, we now have two additional memories for the line buffers that we added for the vertical derivative function. So linebuff 0 and linebuff 1 arrays have both been mapped to memories with one read port and one write port. And we also still have the very large internal memories for storing the results of the vertical and horizontal derivatives. These memories are quite large, over a megabyte each, and we will need to deal with this as one of the design requirements is to minimize on-chip memory storage. The reason why the performance is 3x slower than our desired goal of approximately 1 pixel per clock cycle is that sequential loops within the same process will execute sequentially in hardware. This means that the vertical gradient must run to completion before the horizontal gradient can run, and the magnitude and angle calculation must wait until both have completed. Expanding the V-row loop for the vertical gradient shows us that the V-column loop is pipelined, but that the V-row loop has been left unpipelined. Looking at the Gantt chart, it can be seen that there is an extra C-step or clock cycle in V row that is used to compute the loop index and loop exit condition. This means for each iteration of V row, we will be adding one extra clock cycle simply to do this computation. The performance could be improved by pipelining the V row loop for the vertical gradient and the H row and M row loops for the horizontal gradient and the magnitude angle. Adding the additional pipelining constraints has caused a scheduling feedback failure. This failure has occurred even though we have architected our code to limit the reading of the dat in memory to once per iteration of the V column loop. We can use the design analyzer to analyze the failed feedback path. Clicking through the feedback path in the design analyzer shows us that the feedback is going from the writing of line buff 1 to the reading of line buff 1. This seems a bit surprising since the C code has been architected to limit the reads or writes to only once per clock cycle. What we have encountered here is a false feedback failure due to Catapult's inability to analyze the memory dependencies within the design. It is important to understand how Catapult analyzes memory dependencies in a pipeline design. Catapult will schedule the memory reads and writes of a memory in different cycles if simultaneous reading and writing to the same address is not supported. This is typically the case for ASIC memories. When the design is pipelined, this will make the reads and the writes appear to overlap, and in this case, Catapult may not be able to prove that there is a potential address conflict. Looking at the approximate schedule for scheduling the reads and writes of line buff 1, we can see that there is a read to line buff 1 in the first clock cycle of the first loop iteration, and then a write to line buff 1 in the second clock cycle of the first loop iteration. And then we start all over again. The second loop iteration reads line buff 1 and writes line buff 1. So there is no overlapping of reads and writes in this unpipelined version of the design. When the design is pipelined, what this makes it look like to Catapult as it analyzes and optimizes the design is that while we are doing the write of the first loop iteration to line buff 1, we are also reading the next loop iteration from line buff 1. In some cases, Catapult cannot prove that the write address and the read address are different and will error out, giving a feedback failure because of the memory dependency. The Catapult scheduler can be told to ignore the memory dependency if the user knows that there is no address conflict. This is done using the ignore memory precedence constraint. Care must be taken here because ignoring a real dependency will create bad logic. The designer must be able to prove to themselves that there is no address conflict. The ignore memory precedence command takes as its arguments a from and a to operation. The feedback dependencies shown in the transcript go from the bottom to the top, so in this case, the dependency is from write to read. Ignore memory precedence constraints should be issued after the Go architect synthesis stage. The ignore memory precedence constraint, in this case, has been partially wildcarded in order to ignore the dependencies for both line buff 1 and line buff 0. The design is now able to schedule. The latency has been improved slightly, but we are still 3x off of our design goals. Not only are we 3x off on our performance goals, but the bill of materials also shows us that there are two internal memories over a megabyte each for the horizontal and vertical derivative results. As a final step, because we've made significant architectural changes, we also want to verify the C code against the original algorithm. And the results show us that we are still getting the same approximate error as the previous example. And at this point, we should also run SC verify verification in order to verify that the RTL and the C code are functionally the same. Running the verification will take several minutes. The SC verify simulation finishes after a couple minutes and comes back with a pass, indicating that the C code and the RTL are equivalent. Looking at the simulation waveforms, the read enable for DAT in goes high after reset and then stays high, indicating that one value is being read per clock cycle. The first reads here are for performing the vertical derivative. There's a slight gap where read enable is deasserted at this point, which is the vertical gradient window ramping down. And then we begin the reading of the horizontal gradient, and we can see that it roughly runs at one read per clock cycle, but there is a one cycle gap at the end of every line. And this is because of the extra loop iteration that has been added in order to have the window ramp up and then ramp down. And finally, after the horizontal gradient finishes the computation, the magnitude and angle computation begins, and the magnitude and angle memory write enable goes high and stays high until all the values have been written out. So what this shows us, though, is that the loops are executing sequentially. The vertical derivative loop runs first, Then the horizontal derivative loop runs, and finally the magnitude and angle calculation runs. In order to achieve our performance requirements, we're going to have those loops run concurrent to one another. This concludes the module on sliding window memory architectures for performance.